Education is what's important. Training, preparation for the expected. Education, preparation for the unexpected.
Good afternoon, Team Krulak community. My name is Major Ian Brown. I'm the Operations Officer at the Brute Krulak Center for Innovation and Creativity. And on behalf of Marine Corps University, the Marine Corps University Foundation, and the Krulak Center, welcome back to the Brutecast, our series designed to connect the worlds of the warfighter and PME with the best in innovative and creative thought. Before we begin, please remember that all opinions expressed here are those of the individual and do not reflect the views of the Krulak Center, Marine Corps University, the United States Marine Corps, or any other agency of the U.S. government. We will also be recording this webcast for the benefit of those in our community of interest who cannot join us today, so we ask that you be mindful of keeping your microphones muted to avoid disrupting the presentation and keep your cameras off to help us stream smoothly. So for today's Brutecast, we're very excited to welcome Elsa B. Kania. Ms. Kania is a non-resident fellow in Indo-Pacific Security with the Institute for the Study of War, where she's contributing to a new project on military learning and the future of war. She is also an adjunct senior fellow with the Technology and National Security Program at the Center for New American Security. Her first book, Fighting to Innovate, should be forthcoming from the Naval Institute Press in 2021. Today, she'll be talking about Chinese military learning in pandemic conditions. Before we start, I ask one last time that you make sure your microphones are and cameras are off if you haven't already done so. We will have a question and answer session following her presentation. So if you have a question, just type it into the group chat and we'll call on you directly to ask your question if you're able to do so over your device. If you don't have a reliable connection to ask the question yourself, then just type that into the chat to indicate as well, and we will ask the question for you on our end. All right, with that, Ms. Kania, over to you.
All right, thank you so much for the kind introduction, and very glad to be joining. And thank you all for coming out this afternoon. I'm looking forward to presenting some research that is quite recent and in some respects ongoing, which is always a bit hazardous, as I may not have answers to all of the questions that are worth asking and responding to, but I will hopefully at least provide a quick overview of some of the trends in terms of how we've seen the performance of the Chinese military and national security community in the midst of the pandemic, and what some of the implications are as we think about questions that may range from China's capacity for scientific innovation to national defense mobilization, in theory and in practice, and the implications for China's capacity to perhaps perform in a great power conflict and sustain that kind of resourcing. So I will be hopefully switching to full screen mode, and let me know if there are any issues with the presentation as I go along. But by way of further contextualization, this is an element of a new project that I'm starting with the Institute for the Study of War, where I'm looking at how the Chinese military is learning and adapting. And for this first paper, which should be forthcoming later this fall, starting to look in particular at what we should learn from in our study of the Chinese military from its performance and experience in the course of the pandemic. And of course, we've all been living through the after effects, and I think the experience and implications of this event in China are especially momentous in some respects. And as these remarks from Xi Jinping highlight, this was really seen as a scenario in which the entire country was on wartime footing. And this was described as well as a situation that necessitated people's warfare as a response. The concept that goes back to the time of Mao Zedong and implies a whole-of-nation mobilization in which everyone must play a part. And of course, this martial metaphor also is fitting insofar as the Chinese military itself, the People's Liberation Army, or PLA, was quite prominently involved, as we'll see, in multiple aspects of the pandemic response. And so we can looking back with a couple months of perspective, at least, on these developments, we can start to understand what this says about the PLA and what this says as well about China's overall approach to national security and how the system may evolve going forward. And yeah, I think it's worth emphasizing that this was a situation that was seen by the Chinese Communist Party as having existential stakes, that how they would perform really would have tremendous implications for their future legitimacy, perhaps even survival. And a lot of the messaging and narrative really highlighted that this was a disaster that could spur progress. This was a moment of hardship that would set China up on its course for rejuvenation if it were to emerge in a strong position. And I think, at least relatively speaking, the strengths of China's responses, I think, will have considerable implications going forward. So there's a couple further reflections starting out to state what is, in some respects, increasingly obvious at this point. The COVID-19 pandemic we've seen playing out over coming up on a year now, within a couple months, is already changing the world order as we know it, and also reshaping the balance of power in some respects. And although this pandemic did start in China, and the city of Wuhan was initially devastated by it, and certainly there were major mistakes by the local government and China's national government at early stages that impeded the response and also contributed to this disease escaping and diffusing to the rest of the world, which may have been inevitable irregardless, but certainly was not helped by some of the initial breakdown of information, limitations of transparency. But on the whole, overall, looking at China's relative success, this does has increased, arguably, Beijing's global influence as it seeks to promote the notion of a Chinese way of fighting the coronavirus, and also enhance leaders' confidence as to the perceived advantages of this party-state model and system. And of course, well, there are initially some expectations that this could be a moment of crisis that would threaten Xi Jinping's power and authority. He appears to have emerged from this moment in a position of increased strength and able to take credit for this relative success, and which has been extensively propagandized in media and in attempts to influence global public opinion. The thing about the strategic context as well in terms of U.S.-China relations, this whole episode has really produced a new nadir, a low point in terms of the breakdown of cooperation one once would have hoped or expected to see on an issue of such global import as health security and a global pandemic. And we've also, at the same time, seen, as I'm sure you all have noticed, the prevalence of mis and disinformation, including an initial swirling rumors that the pandemic might even be a bioweapon. And I think that some of this mis and disinformation, which has continued and may have lasting impacts in terms of public opinion, also highlights the extent of the mistrust between the U.S. and China. And I think this will certainly be a legacy of this event going forward. And as we think about how this episode is played out within the United States as well, arguably some of our failures as a country to look to and learn lessons from China's initial experiences contributed to what, by most accounts and estimations, is a fairly dysfunctional American response. So I think we have to look at honestly and recognize where we can learn from our own mistakes, or where we might look to and learn from the mistakes or strengths of other countries in their response, especially since, as we look to the years ahead, I think there certainly is a very real risk and threat that we will see future pandemics and increasing security concerns when it comes to biosecurity, whether that is with the advent of synthetic biology, threats of actual bioweapons rather than rumors of them, or any number of natural pathogens and disasters that will really test the strength and resilience of every nation and of every military. And certainly, while discussing the U.S. military's experiences with the pandemic would be beyond the scope of this presentation, I think that can make for an interesting comparison, because I think this has really raised concerns about readiness, about the capacity to have the appropriate procedures and supplies in place. And as we'll see, the PLA, in some respects, appears to have fared fairly well, at least as best as can be told, with the enormous caveat that there are significant disparities of transparency between these two systems. Right. So certainly, as we all should know, these kinds of non-traditional security threats are not new and not a surprise necessarily. And in fact, China's latest National Defense White Paper on its National Defense in the New Era last summer had highlighted the concerns of these new security issues, the risks of natural disasters or major epidemics. And China had, in some respects, appeared to be relatively prepared in terms of its system for disease surveillance. So, of course, That also had broken down in the midst of the crisis with some corruption of data due to human incentives. But all in all, there was some anticipation of these risks within China's national security community and concern about biosecurity as a new element of national security. But arguably, this hadn't been sufficiently institutionalized, and especially the early failings of the response in the pandemic and difficulties of coordination and information sharing did highlight the need for new reforms and changes. And I think beyond looking at this as a broader concern of national defense, the Chinese military itself has defined roles and responsibilities in disaster response, including for epidemic control and medical relief. And I think some of this also speaks to unique features of the PLA in its self-image and its role within the system. The PLA, as we all should recall, is a party army, not a national military. Certainly the CCP continues to remind and emphasize on that point. And it also is, in terms of its history and tradition and the narrative around it, a people's army, and an army that has more roles and responsibilities in terms of domestic security than the U.S. military or most other militaries by comparison. And as we'll see, the PLA played a role in the epidemic response and control that was relatively unique and I think highlighted some of the strengths and potential weaknesses of these features of this military within a party state system. So the PLA was not approaching this pandemic de novo. It certainly has its own history and experiences, positive and negative, that informed both some of the individuals involved in this response, as well as the institutional considerations that came into play, and some elements of this history are somewhat ignominious. So back in 2003, during the SARS outbreak, there actually was a serious incident where the outbreak came to Beijing via cases in a PLA hospital that were actually concealed not only from the international community, but also from China's own leadership. And this was really seen at the time as a breakdown in party-army relations, that the PLA was hiding these cases of SARS from the party, and this was only uncovered when a whistleblower came forward and revealed that the outbreak was already underway, in a military hospital. And I should say, as a quick note as well, and happy to speak to this in more detail, another perhaps interesting element of the PLA is that it does have a quite considerable military medical community. There are many PLA hospitals, including the general hospital, a couple of specialized hospitals, and and those associated with each service. There are major research institutions like the Academy of Military Medical Sciences. So there is a relatively strong capacity and expertise within the PLA on medical issues, and especially folks who are sort of specialized and less on a command track than essentially doctors in uniform. Again, not a phenomenon unique to the Chinese military, but definitely I think a prominent element of the PLA, and one that also, as we think about this establishment, its implications for future considerations of military medicine on the battlefield, or even how the PLA handles psychological preparedness in terms of mental health and readiness. So this community is, I think, important as we look at the story, and it has quite robust experiences across these different incidents, again, from the SARS outbreak to later involvement in China's national response to the Sichuan earthquake, which in many respects revealed a lack of preparedness. And some of the most recent and relevant aspects from which the PLA directly drew lessons learned for this crisis was the deployment of military health workers to Sierra Leone and Liberia back in 2014 during the fight against Ebola. And we should remember that the PLA does not have all that much experience in terms of overseas operations. So military operations other than war are actually an important element of how the PLA is learning to start to position itself as a more global military. So for instance, preparing personnel to go overseas, ensuring that the families at home would be cared for, ensuring that there'd be enough expertise in terms of liaising with local partners. A lot of really practical considerations came into how came into these initial deployments to join the campaign against Ebola, which included prominently a dedicated Chinese hospital for Ebola treatment, and some of the studies and after-action reports that came out of NALTA professionals who had been deployed for this mission highlighted that they were proud of their track record. They reportedly maintained a record of zero infections among their own personnel by having pretty robust procedures in place, informed by guidance from the World Health Organization. However, there were some issues like running short of, in terms of protective gear and materials, having some difficulties interacting and coordinating with local partners in these countries. So, yeah, and as we'll later see, many of the personnel who were deployed in China to Wuhan for the fight against the coronavirus had started out and learned a lot from some of these more formative experiences with SARS and with Ebola. And I think the relative salience of these events, I think, also highlighted the importance of epidemic preparedness as an element of the CLA's mission of disaster relief and response. So if we look, again, I won't go through the sequence of events in Wuhan that has been very widely covered in the media and is well established, but if we look, and certainly there were some delays in the initial stages. At first, the Chinese military seemed to be missing or less engaged in that response, which appears to have been less a military issue than perhaps one of coordination or civil-military relations in terms of the kind of initial delay between the communication of the central, of the local to the central government. So there was something of a lag time before the PLA was fully mobilized and deployed in support of the response in Wuhan, which occurred around late January 2020. And in particular, this was a test for a new element of the PLA, the Joint Logistics Support Force, which had been created in the course of its reforms back in early 2016 or so, and it's also an interesting experiment in large-scale logistics and military transport, including the use of military aircraft, including the Y-20 in its first peacetime deployment to convey supplies from all over China to Wuhan. And beyond simply logistics and materiel, there was a focus on bringing the human expertise required for this campaign. With thousands of medical personnel across multiple hospitals in the PLA, different medical research institutions, especially those with prior experience in epidemic control, were deployed to Wuhan in several waves of personnel, and it even became necessary to recall some of those who had already retired and were older and but had some of that past experience, or even there's, as we'll see, fairly extensive leveraging of reserves and militia personnel in the first couple waves of extra zero there, but 6,600 military medical workers were involved, and this was an important contribution to the capacity of Wuhan as a city when it was initially swamped in the early stages of the epidemic to get the epidemic under control, including the rapid construction, as captured quite a few headlines at the time, of large-scale hospitals that the military was responsible for managing, and of course also throughout China, the different military hospitals had their own roles to play in terms of managing patients. So I think this military capacity leveraged for medical purposes was an important element of the surge that it took for China to control the pandemic. And by most accounts, again, I should hasten to add, especially as a researcher who uses only open sources on these topics, there are definite limitations in what I'm seeing and what I know relative to what might be less transparent, especially with the current media environment. There are some relatively honest and straightforward critiques that arise even in official sources of some of the shortfalls or challenges, again, the having to call up multiple rounds of reinforcements, the extreme stress and burnout that military medical workers suffered, some of the shortages of supplies that had to be rapidly remedied. But I think in some cases, at least the story the PLA is telling itself in the world, is that this was a successful campaign on the whole. And we should regard the PLA's role in pandemic response as an element of a larger feature of China's national strategy and system that is relatively unique, perhaps, in some respects, in terms of the extent of attention to dysfunction, and that is the notion of national defense mobilization, which has often highlighted as a priority, especially over the past couple of years under Xi Jinping. And this is relevant not only to disasters or emergencies at home, but also to how China would be preparing to mobilize for a big war, such as a great power conflict. And this notion of national defense mobilization, again, which relates to the more traditional concept of people's warfare, and essentially the idea of having a whole of society, expansive response, is relatively more comprehensive than we typically think about mobilization in an American context. So, for instance, this isn't just about mobilizing military power. This involves economic, political, information, transportation, and technological resources. And a study of the system and the kinds of strategy it supports would be beyond the scope of what I can speak to today. I'll barely scratch the surface of it, but I'd say that this one of the most significant takeaways we might have from looking at China's national responses in the pandemic is that national defense mobilization is not just a system that exists on paper or in theory or as a concept that's discussed. It actually has a great deal of relevance and a perhaps more capacity than might have been expected in terms of core functions and intentions of trying to integrate civil and military efforts. And this has, again, relevance not only to how we saw China in the pandemic, but also the continuation of long-term peacetime preparation for potential wartime contingencies, some of the reforms that we've seen so far, such as the creation of a new department under the Central Military Commission to consolidate authorities for national defense mobilization, has been important and arguably performed with perhaps relatively effectively in this crisis, despite, again, some breakdowns in coordination between mobilization with disaster response and among the different stakeholders involved. But I think this is a topic that I think will merit much more extensive consideration as we think about the degree to which China is able to perhaps bring to bear unique advantages in this aspect of great power competition. And we saw the system in action in the crisis. Again, I've lots to discuss here. Some of my research has barely scratched the surface, but the activation of this mechanism concentrated on trying to bring to bear engagement among different stakeholders, so for instance, the military, working with different localities, local governments, and although we typically think of China's security forces in terms of the military, perhaps paramilitary, like people gone police, there's also a quite extensive system of militias in China, and these play a relatively prominent role in the course of the pandemic, and the functions they were called up to play were relatively mundane, so ensuring Wuhan had fresh vegetables at the height of the crisis, supporting local transport and logistics, major companies weren't operating, and perhaps a simple but important responsibility as well as public education and messaging, because militias were more embedded within local communities, they were called upon to disseminate information about hygiene, about how to respond in a pandemic, wearing masks, and so forth. Again, this may seem very simple and mundane, but as we've seen here in the United States as well, these are really important if you're trying to have a societal response and general resilience, and these grassroots efforts by local militias were mobilized in the tens and tens of thousands, not only in Wuhan, but across China, were seen as important and demonstrating the advantages of this grassroots approach. And of course, there's also a concern with the public security and social stability here. Some of the militias were encouraged to help shape public opinion and eventually propagandize how successful the party's response would be. But again, sort of some of the basic functions of ensuring supplies were delivered and also facilitating the scaling up of personal protective equipment and medical equipment were important elements of how we saw national defense mobilization come into play. And some of this was, again, low-tech, folks going door-to-door. And in other cases, it is more sophisticated databases of companies with capacity to manufacture PPE or risk-related supplies that could be called upon to rapidly scale up manufacturing, coordination to resolve shortages, attempts to coordinate different localities support each other, depending on which were more or less in need. So yeah, I think this is kind of a pretty unique feature of China's response, one that perhaps could take place only in China, but I think also one that highlights that sort of having thinking about national defense and thinking about what it means to mobilize and respond to a crisis in a more holistic manner and across a range of stakeholders, across a range of issue areas can be a significant advantage. Of course, this could be another discussion unto itself, but another interesting element and another thing we can look to and learn from and in seeking to understand China's capabilities as well as the role that different emerging technologies played in providing what Xi Jinping described as S&T support for the crisis response. And we've seen Chinese leaders consistently emphasize the importance of innovation, national security, national rejuvenation. Here there was a fair amount of experimentation with new techniques and technologies, bringing to bear advances in research as well as the capabilities of different companies in the space. So extensive use of big data analytics for tracing and monitoring the epidemic in different hospitals. AI systems were used for assistance, whether that was, for instance, medical consultations or reading through scans and to help them doctors process and diagnose more rapidly. Also interesting interceptions that we've seen in Chinese and international research of how being able to use these kinds of analytics can accelerate basic research as well. Of course, there's been a lot of hype about 5G, but in this case, 5G had relatively practical utility when it came to enabling thermal imaging as surveillance, if you had a temperature, and general disease surveillance. Again, China's overall surveillance systems and capabilities may be reinforced and redoubled in response to the added role these plays during the crisis. Also was quite extensive use of drones and 5G-enabled robotic systems, as you can see on the right here, whether for delivering supplies or disinfection or supporting doctors and hospitals. Again, none of this is particularly groundbreaking, but a lot of it was simply bringing to bear existing platforms or technologies or commercial capabilities in this context. And 5G is also relevant in terms of telemedicine, large-scale video conferencing, consultation among multiple hospitals throughout China. And practically, again, as we're all seeing the importance of connectivity in our day-to-day lives, another effort we may see redouble in China, and that is beneficial, was ways in which 5G could relate to remote education. And as we've seen in the months since, Xi Jinping has highlighted the importance of the construction of new type infrastructure such as 5G as an important element of China's economic recovery as well. So another element when we think about the role that the PLA played in the pandemic that's important to take notice and has received a fair amount of attention is how directly it was involved in development of the vaccine. And Major General Chen Wei, who's been highlighted as a hero and lauded for her efforts and also had experience in the past with Ebola and other epidemics, was involved in one of the first vaccine candidates to go into use. The collaboration between the Academy of Military Medical Sciences, the company for vaccine that has gone through multiple rounds of trials and actually been been approved at an early stage for use in and by the military, as well as by employees of state-owned enterprises and patented. And this, of course, has raised some ethical concerns considerations when it comes to the fact that that is a very rapid timeline in which to develop a vaccine. We've had similar debates and concerns in the U.S. around Operation Warp Speed, but of China's approach and the fact that folks are already getting vaccinated and including those who may not be in a position to readily refuse or who may be eager to do so without full awareness of the risks. That does, in some respects, perhaps set a dangerous precedent, but also highlights the degree to which the development of a vaccine is seen as vital and one where we'll continue to see efforts accelerating there. And, of course, Although one would hope that the development of vaccine would be collaborative in nature, this has been framed as competitive, as a race for a vaccine with not just national prestige and health, but also geopolitical considerations in place. And I note that China has also pledged it would make the vaccine widely available to the world in an equitable manner, including, for instance, to countries in Africa and others that may not have as ready access to vaccines developed in the U.S. or Europe. And I would hope the U.S. would also commit to making sure vaccines developed by American companies are equitably available, and instead of an approach that puts Americans ahead of the rest of the world there, but there are complex considerations in play when it comes to geopolitics and the process of testing and ways in which as well some of this relates to China's focus on Health Silk Road and its overall diplomacy. So, and another important element to note when we look at the PLA and its experience in the course of the pandemic is that beyond the elements of the PLA that were directly involved in the response, whether healthcare or research, there also were, of course, elements of the PLA that were simply trying to sustain day-to-day readiness and training. And yeah, I think Chinese military has never been known for its transparency. This crisis has been no exception. There are reasons to be very skeptical, but the PLA did maintain a perfect record with zero infections throughout the entire force, especially given, as we saw, how many military medical workers were really on the front lines of this, as well as the size of the PLA, the number of units throughout China, their interaction with local communities, that at least that has been something of the official narrative. And so, yeah, again, I think reasons to be skeptical of that, but also if there were significant infections of a large scale within the PLA, that might have at some point come out as well. So perhaps a middle-of-the-road assessment would be that the PLA whether this relative health, and at least relatively speaking, and there does appear to have been implementation of fairly strict procedures in terms of health and safety. And again, some of the important actions here were fairly mundane, so attention to hygiene and nutrition, how different Chinese and older dining halls were disinfecting and ensuring healthy food was available to maintain immunity. There was regular monitoring of temperatures and health examinations. There's also concern both for units in general and the frontline medical workers about their mental health and psychological pressures. And some of this can be linked to sort of broader concerns from the PLA about psychological readiness and how personnel would respond to under wartime conditions, or in this case, pandemic conditions in terms of burnout, responses to trauma. And yeah, so that certainly was an element that PLA had to grapple with as well in the course of this, of trying to make mental health resources and support available to personnel and continuing training to the best of their ability with masks, with social distancing. Again, not concerns or challenges unique to the PLA, but certainly something in which it had to learn and adapt to put these procedures in place. And at least, again, relatively speaking, again, the Chinese military does appear to have sustained, for the most part, just much of its regular calendar of training and operations, and to have also focused on readiness and the importance of highlighting that as an element of deterrence, lest there be any concern that China was weakened or the PLA was let go as a in the course of the crisis. And again, reasons for skepticism, but also reasons to look to the PLA as a force that took this quite seriously and tried, as every military in the world has had, to balance these competing imperatives under crisis conditions. And as we've seen, PLA also, beyond continuing exercises and training, has been actively involved in the intersection of health and military diplomacy. Seeing the Chinese military of the past decade or so in particular really scale up its engagement in pursuit of military-to-military relations with different countries, especially those more aligned to China's interests, and trying to expand partnerships and joint exercises. the course of the crisis, the PLA has contributed to providing medical supplies and different medical teams and workers to a number of different countries, especially those that are friendlier with China in many respects, and providing masks, supplies. The PLA could also be involved, as we saw, in the testing of the vaccine overseas, and this highlights ways in which we're seeing this intersection of military engagement with the broader concerns about geopolitical influence and the notion of a health growth road, and of course for the Chile again, as a force that doesn't have a tremendous amount of experience in deployment, going overseas, partnering with local forces, even helping to train them in healthcare procedures, further adds to overseas experience and capacity in terms of partnership. So again, there's definitely a lot to unpack here. I've not fully scratched the surface in my remarks. We're definitely trying to leave enough time for questions and to go deeper into these topics as well. But as a quick summation of some general thoughts and lessons learned and implications going forward, I think it's fair to say that this campaign against the pandemic, people's warfare, could be, in some respects, a formative experience for the Chinese military and for China's national security community as a whole. That the national mobilization we saw also highlights the Chinese system in terms of the capacity for rapid response and the focus on leveraging all available resources, including enlisting companies and commercial enterprises in this endeavor. As we saw some early stages relating to crisis, some of the weaknesses in terms of shortcomings and the breakdown of the initial information sharing, the difficulty of coordinating, and there's so many different stakeholders involved. Whether from the military and local levels or different institutions of government or different medical institutions or companies. And you know, the future reforms and changes we see in the wake of this. And these may also be a source of insight in terms of where Chinese leaders in different contexts saw flaws or saw problems arise and are seeking to remedy them. So for instance, the focus on the biosecurity laws we'll see and the concern with improving military medical readiness and supplies will be a legacy of this today. And yeah, definitely a lot to look ahead to, but one element of that, of course, will be China's new law on biosecurity, which is still pending approval, but some of the measures it proposes to have it in coordination, information sharing, having a better response system going forward, and again, highlights a lesson that I think every nation should learn in the wake of this pandemic, that biosecurity is important to national security, that there has to be, that there are compelling reasons to pursue innovation in the sector and also the capacity to respond to potential threats going forward. And if we think about the longer term implications in China's lessons learned from the crisis, international security, as well as economic security, there's also growing attention to strategic emerging industries, which are seen as important drivers of growth in China's recovery. And just recently, a new guiding opinion came out looking at strategic emerging industries and these new growth points. And some respects this might be characterized as a follow-on to Made in China 2025, a sort of highlighting of critical priorities for leadership and the direction in which Chinese economy is intended to concentrate going forward. And one of the emphases of this plan, for which I was involved in the collaborative translation, you can find by DigiChina if you're interested to read in full. One of the emphases here was focusing on the development of the biotech industry, not only promoting innovation, but also risk prevention and management, and continued investments in biosecurity and emergency response. So evidently, despite some of the apparent successes and declarations of victory, there is still seen an urgent need to increase national scientific capabilities as well as emergency response in the main going forward. And I think when we think about the strategic significance and reasons for concern, as we think about U.S.-China rivalry today in some respects as a context of systems and models on the world stage, there's been an increased attention in whether statements by Xi Jinping or state media and propaganda on the notion that China's performance in this critical crisis illustrates its systemic superiority or institutional advantage, that essentially the degree to which the CCP was able to respond rapidly, mobilize response, and succeed in that endeavor is is an indication that this is a model of success and a one in which this kind of centralized and unified leadership provides positive externalities. And yeah, then as the unfavorable contrast that Chinese Navy is often raised is that separation of power systems, i.e. the U.S., has more constraints, friction, and ineffective governance. And I think if we are to think about the aftermath of this crisis and the implications for the democracies on the world stage, I think Beijing will continue to point out and take some apparent satisfaction in pointing out the elements of the U.S. response that have proven less effective or even dysfunctional, and this does play directly into propaganda and broader information environment and the CCP's efforts to legitimize itself, promote its model, and its influence on the world stage. So I think there is perhaps an element of truth in terms of the success and capacity of the system, but I think what is less visible and definitely more difficult is it really true, or especially in the media environment, to highlight is some of the distinct disadvantages of this as well, that of course have become very apparent in extremis, whether that is the enormous inefficiencies and corruption or the cruelty and ethical concerns that come into play, including as we've seen with the concerns about the testing of a vaccine and the trajectory of those efforts, as well as, of course, the situation in Xinjiang, where there have been outbreaks as well, and where those who are detained in large-scale concentration camps are at a huge risk of this disease, and again, very limited information there as well. And I think so long as this also is a system where there can be disincentives to reporting bad news and to being fully transparent, that is a source of weakness as well. So again, I think we will be trying to reckon this and make sense of how to look at how the pandemic played out in China and in the United States here as well for years and years to come. But I think that it is important to study and look to China's sense of its own experiences, its claims, the stories that Chinese leaders will tell themselves and tell their citizens in the world about the lessons that they're learning from this and their takeaways. And certainly this is an element of that discourse that's become quite prominent, whether in Chinese or English language medium reporting. So I guess I will stop there for now. I think I hope I've provided a decent overview of the topics. I'm definitely happy to keep in touch going forward, probably too many different email accounts and too many different projects I'm pursuing these days, but this is hopefully the start of a paper and effort that I'm going to be working on going forward. So I'll welcome questions, and I'll also welcome any critiques or guidance on what didn't I cover, what would be worth delving into more deeply, or what are some of the gaps in this analysis? Because I think there's definitely a lot to unpack here, and I hope this has been a decently interesting introduction to some of these themes and dynamics. And thanks again to you all for coming out virtually, and hope you're all well and staying healthy yourselves.
Great. Thank you, Elsa. I'm Dr. Brandon Valeriano. I'm Brand Chair at the Krulak Center. I'm just coming online. I had to go to an appointment just before this. But I've known Elsa for a long time, too long. I met her as an undergrad. So it's a pretty truthful statement when I say that it's a pleasure to watch her development and watch her become a central person in this field. I'm going to ask a few questions, and then we'll turn it over to the audience Q&A. Either raise your hand in the chat or just ask your hand in the chat. We prefer, though, that you use your own voice to ask a question, but that's the plan. So please think of your questions, because it is a delight and it's an important opportunity that we have to pick Elsa's brain here for a minute or two. Let me ask you a little bit about research. After doing all this work and after studying China for a long time and after consulting with the U.S. government, I saw you named in another Future of Defense report I got sent. What do we need to do to understand Chinese capabilities better? What are we missing? Where are we failing?
Let's see. So I have a lot of thoughts on this front, just trying to think where to start. So I think that I'll start by the fact that it alarms me sometimes how few of us there can be who are really looking at these issues in depth, reading the primary sources, going through what's readily available in the open source. I think there's starting to be more of a community around this, and initiatives like the one I mentioned, DigiChina, where we work on collaborative translations to make some of these materials more accessible are important, I think. But yeah, there was a recent study that came out from the House looking at how the intelligence community, for instance, is responding to the China challenge. And one of the critiques or points raised was the importance of leveraging the open source more fully. And I think that's something that whether for those of us who are academics or independent researchers or those working in governmental capacities is important. And I think I definitely think there is, for all that China is often described as non-transparent, there often is far more information available than the, again, sort of relatively small relative to what you might expect community of us who are trying to dive into this can keep up with. So we are living in an age of big data, and I think definitely one of the shortcomings of my own research and methodology has been trying to be more systematic about it, because to some degree there's definitely a lot you can glean and sometimes add to the conversation simply just by reading what is written in Chinese and that is not being discussed or making it into the conversation as much within the U.S. And I think this does speak to a more general information asymmetry, whether in terms of science or defense or otherwise, where there's much more attention sometimes in China to what's happening in Washington, D.C. or Silicon Valley than vice versa, though I hope that it's starting to change. And I think we do have to kind of look at the state of play in China, whether in research or policy responses, and take seriously what is happening there. And yeah, I think definitely in terms of sort of building up a pipeline and research community, there's a lot more that can and should be done on that front. I'm actually involved in an initiative called the U.S.-China Futures Project that we launched this summer. We've had a series of task forces meeting that are trying to tackle different questions in U.S.-China relations, whether global health or looking at military-civil fusion or trying to understand potential American responses at home to some of these challenges. We're trying to bring together people from different backgrounds and perspectives, including some scientists, including some folks who aren't specialists on China, but bring relevant expertise and perspective. And yeah, so hopefully there's more momentum on this front. And I will stop there. I think there's a lot more to be done, and definitely I try, although I'm still at a pretty early stage in the field myself, to be welcoming and supportive, especially when more folks are looking to start working on this, because there is more work to be done and more questions to answer than any of us individually can ever hope or expect to be able to tackle.
Great. I certainly empathize with you there. It feels like cybersecurity is a big community, but when you really get down to it, it's really not in some ways. And that's really a challenge for investigating emergent technology. Let me ask you what China, how they took what America did during the pandemic. One, how much were we able to leverage 5G in trying to stall the pandemic? And what has our pandemic response taught China about us, the United States?
I'm afraid my answer on this front will be incredibly pessimistic. I guess one quick take would be here in the U.S., we've been caught up in conspiracy theories about 5G causing the pandemic and folks trying to talk to their faith healers about the perils of 5G and burn down 5G cell towers, whereas in China, the Chinese government has actually been looking to sort of leverage and deploy 5G much more pragmatically to for disease surveillance and telemedicine. So definitely there's more robust responses in terms of tech policy in the U.S. and trying to accelerate broadband deployment, especially given issues of equity and disparities in connectivity that we're seeing play out with remote education. But I know that there's been some tremendous innovation in terms of American researchers and American companies in the space, whether in the development of the vaccine or a treatment. I think the fact that Chinese hackers have been targeting just about every American company that's working on this is a sign that for all the claims that China has the first or the best vaccine, there's still concern or perhaps insecurity as to other efforts in trying to get access to U.S. research in the space. And yeah, on the flip side of that, there's actually a great deal of collaborative research between American and Chinese scientists as well, which some interesting studies leveraging, looking at co-authorship or leveraging bibliometrics on that front. So there's definitely a tension or contradiction there as well, where there has been a lot of geopolitical blustering, and yet scientists encouragingly are still working together and collaborating in some cases. And I guess with regard to Chinese leaders' perspective on the U.S. response, I think, frankly, as I mentioned a bit earlier, I think to the extent our response has been, frankly, dysfunctional, this factors directly into that narrative and propaganda that a democracy or system with separation of powers is inherently inferior to one in which there is intense centralization of power, such as we've seen with the party state and especially Xi Jinping's leadership. And he has a lot of the success attributed to him personally, whether he deserves it or not. And of course, the flip side is that any massive failures could come to his door as well. But I think when it comes to how Chinese leaders think about the rise and fall of great powers, about China's national rejuvenation and how the U.S. is being eclipsed in that process, I think to the extent that our response has been far less effective than anticipated, given that the U.S. was generally considered to be quite well prepared for a pandemic before all of this, I think it does highlight, does throw into quite stark relief some of the domestic weaknesses that China doesn't even have to do very much to capitalize upon, because we are doing this to ourselves in some cases, and simply it's incumbent upon Chinese media or propaganda to point out what is actually happening and put a bit of a spin on it, relative to trying to tell their own story in a much more favorable light, whether merited or not. So I think that, there has been evidently a great deal of attention to the crisis in the U.S. from China, and I think this will also have implications for instance, the willingness of Chinese students to come to study in the U.S., the willingness of Chinese tourists to come to the U.S., and to the extent to which America is seen as a safe and healthy and functional country, I think has really been delivered a blow in terms of public opinion and popular perception.
Okay, thanks. And my last one is, what should we take away from this and from Chinese capabilities? Do you think we should fear China more or less after this? What's your feeling on that issue overall?
I guess I think in terms of lessons learned, I wish in earlier stages of the crisis, if we had a time machine, if only, we would look more seriously at how the Chinese government was responding and handling this and tried to learn from the positive and negative elements of their response. I think there were a number of researchers and scientists in the U.S. who were trying to communicate with colleagues in China and glean those lessons learned and very closely following the news on that front. But I think some of that gap and the failure to look at the experiences of Wuhan as a city and China's national response as something from which we could learn in trying to implement our own response, I think that was a mistake. I think I think we shouldn't necessarily look at this in terms of fear, but recognize that we have to start reckoning with some of our own brittleness or our failures of resilience at home if we're going to hope to compete with China effectively and constructively on the world stage, whether that is leadership in international institutions or even military readiness. I mean, I think, frankly, some of the cases where there were major outbreaks from the U.S. military, including with the Theodore Roosevelt and some of the incidents and concerns there, as well as the I think some of that may impact how China views American military readiness. I think the answer is not to have folks constantly at sea in response to some of the recent reporting, but rather to sort of think more critically about health and having adequate supplies available. I mean, I can speak less well to that element of things, but I think, there's been a lot of talk lately about what American strategy should look like going forward. I would I would tend to agree or be of the school of thought that concentrating on security in terms of resilience, whether that's in cybersecurity or pandemic preparedness, will be all the more important. And yeah, I think, again, although I work and concentrate often on China from a defense perspective, I keep coming back to we can't compete or sustain competition on any dimension unless we are able to fix the fundamentals at home, whether that's education or healthcare or sort of basic assurance of quality of life and social services. So I think there's a lot to do, and I think that this some of these issues of domestic politics and policy end up being inextricable from geopolitics and our capacity to be and to be seen as a great power on the world stage as well.
Firstly, thanks very much for the brilliant presentation. My question relates to your publications recently on Chinese military civil fusion, specifically around have you observed any notable civil governmental military fusion in the Chinese COVID-19 response that specifically relates to Chinese big tech with Baidu, Alibaba, Tencent, and Huawei?
Absolutely. That's a great question. I should have been perhaps a bit more explicit about that in the presentation, but I think, certainly there's been, as I mentioned a bit, a fairly extensive collaboration of military researchers with civilian researchers and companies in vaccine development, the sort of national defense mobilization system, as well as different militias and military units involved to coordinate with local companies in terms of trying to step up manufacture of military equipment and protective equipment. There was a fair amount, and some of this sort of less military civil fusion and more simply public-private cooperation of a number of leading technology companies, including in AI, supporting different hospitals in terms of AI-enabled diagnostics, for instance. And I think that to some degree, military civil fusion as a concept and strategy is expansive enough that the National Defense Mobilization System in and of itself is considered an example and use case of it. And when you have, and also it's a system that goes both ways. So having the military support civilian efforts, so the military personnel augmenting civilian healthcare workers is equally military civil fusion as having civilian supporting the military. So I think arguably in some respects in the pandemic, we saw multiple elements of military civil fusion as a system or strategy going in both directions, the military supporting civilian efforts, as well as different civilian companies, especially tech companies, whether in AI or robotics, so supporting sort of national defense in a more expansive sense than purely the military in terms of getting enlisted in developing new disease surveillance systems or supporting diagnostics in different hospitals. So, yeah, I think this is an interesting test case on a number of levels. I'm still, frankly, insofar as my research is ongoing, I'm still trying to sort through more specifically, trying to get looking more at different companies involved and the extent to which this also was a successful example of the use of big data, even simply in having better statistics and information on which were the companies, the military, or local pandemic response efforts should be drawing upon. And one ongoing element of reforms to in MCF, the National Defense Mobilization, is this focus on sort of having the big data and information, whether that's through sort of databases of relevant enterprises that are part, or even local associations of companies that are involved in military civil fusion or defense mobilization, and being able to enlist them in those efforts. So, yeah, I think there's definitely many elements of this that do relate to that concept, and I think in some respects this highlights also how the PLA is more closely integrated with society relative to many of their militaries. I think there's a similar question perhaps in the chat as well. Just pull that back up. But.
Yeah, hi there. Very much enjoyed the presentation. Look forward to the next couple. Now, my question has to do with just PRC's mentality, kind of with regards to COVID, but sort of all the time. Do they see themselves as a nation at war, quote unquote, where they're always under threat and always this mobilization and these various defense skills, whether it's first aid or, driving trucks and setting up hospitals and all this sort of thing that goes on behind the scenes that probably doesn't get a lot of, I wouldn't think it gets a lot of publicity or visibility. But does the country see itself always in conflict?
Yes and no, and perhaps differently from the Soviet Union, for lack of a better framing there. And I think that there is a sense of constant threat, especially in terms of concerns of regime security when it comes to the CCP itself and the notion that hostile foreign forces are constantly assaulting China, especially in the realm of information and attempts to undermine the CCP's authority or ideology or legitimacy. So I think there's sort of a sense of constant conflict when it comes to cognition, ideology, psychology, sort of concerns about monitoring and managing public opinion and controlling influences that are seen as damaging or threatening on that front. I think sort of in terms of the ethos of national defense mobilization, there are, I think the militia system is an interesting illustration of that, of sort of having sort of different units that specialize in cyber defense or drone operations or folks who have experience in video gaming that seem as relevant, and sort of having folks who are from local companies or different professional backgrounds getting, having some connection to the system and the capacity to be mobilized. In extremis, whether in a crisis like this or perhaps in a conflict scenario as well, there's been a lot of attention to the maritime militias, the fishermen who are sometimes prone to harass U.S. ships and sometimes like to play with lasers, apparently, and sort of get all sorts of harassment sort of in support of Chinese maritime claims. I think the rest of the militia system has received less attention, but it is, I think, significant in terms of having this latent capacity to bring tens of thousands of further people to interplay in a crisis with different specialties and professions, and even simply having people going door to door to make sure people know how to wash their hands properly and wear masks and promoting hygiene practices. So, I think beyond that, in terms of training and defense, one interesting, sometimes controversial dimension of this mentality or approach in China is that most incoming university students have several weeks of basic military training they go through. And in some respects, indicative of the generational shifts in China, there have been concerns that sometimes, again, not necessarily unique to China, but the gap between generations, I think, is especially stark in that context, given just the very different moments in Chinese history that folks have lived through. And sometimes Chinese millennials are sort of caricatured by perhaps senior officers in the PLA as sort of spoiled only children who are too soft and need to be toughened up, and concerns about teeth disease, sometimes recurrent PLA writings. And I think the focus of sort of having some of basic military training to students is one element of that. And sort of I think having different associations and sort of also mechanisms of the party to focus on mobilization, such as the neighborhood committees, were also involved in health and hygiene during the crisis, the suspect approach as well. And I've looked less closely at other elements such as civil air defense. I know there's some efforts underway there as well, but I think it's definitely a great question and interesting comparison. And I think there definitely are perhaps parallels or influences, but not quite perhaps the same. The same style of system as the USSR had initially in the time frame.
Great, thank you.
I see my other participants are not exactly beating down the door to ask a question. So if I could ask a follow-up to an earlier point about how PRC sees the American response, and this sort of goes back to your one answer that I think the American response is so sui generis, bizarro, one-off response that, and I know PRC would prefer to compare itself to America, but do you know how they looked at, say, non-authoritarian success stories like Germany or New Zealand or Taiwan or some of these places that are democratic nations and governments but had a much more successful response to COVID?
I don't think we're likely to see China State media praising Taiwan on this front, certainly. And I think that I haven't looked for these commentaries as directly. I would suspect we'll see more studies and more after-action reviews as sort of this research and sort of general global debate about what we should learn and take away from this crisis continues going forward. But I think at least the official narrative in state media is very much that China is fairly unique in its advantages and sort of highlighting those that center on the mobilization of resources, coordination, centralized leadership. And I think the narrative has very much highlighted the features of China's response that were successful and that are perhaps more unique to a system that is relatively authoritarian, and especially, again, a lot of this from the lens of ideology attributed to Xi Jinping personally or to the Chinese Communist Party and its dedication to the people. So there's very much that is the frame through which the party sees this, and that is the narrative that is coming out of state media. I haven't seen as much coverage of other cases of success in other democracies. A lot of the criticism certainly has been centered upon the U.S. and other countries in Europe that have been less successful, and sort of China's willingness to support the rest of the world has been when it needs that support. It's sort of an element of it stepping up as a responsible stakeholder in its own way. But yeah, that's an interesting question. I can get back to you if I see any more on that front. Always more to read than I have time to.
Great. I think that's actually all for the questions. I'll ask one final one, and then if anyone wants to stick around and engage Elsa for a little bit, whatever time she can give us would be great. But I'll end with Major Brown will come on right after you're done. But can you tell us what you're working on, what you're planning on right now, and what do you think is interesting to you in the research front?
Not too much at once, as always. I guess the main thing I'm focusing on at the moment is getting the paper that this presentation is based off of out soon. So I'm in the middle of some revisions on that front. So stay tuned after this, coming up with a sort of study of war sometime later this fall. I'm looking forward to getting that out there. And I've been collaborating on this with a colleague, Ian McCaslin, who's done some great work on this as well. And we're continuing to look at Chinese military medical research in that community. Also some interesting questions that arise in the context of how to think about the research collaboration when there's a strong military element to it. And that's certainly a timely topic as well. Just beyond that, I'm trying to work on finishing up revisions on the book, and that's certainly occupying a fair amount of my time as well. I'm trying to revisit and integrate themes and pieces of work I've been doing. Really, I guess we're coming up on 5 years now, looking at innovation in different domains of emerging technologies in China and how to make sense of that both today and looking forward, as well as in historical perspective and some of the continuities we can see even looking back to the time of Deng Xiaoping and or even further back to Mao's more contested relationship with science. So I think there's certainly a lot happening in the realm of emerging technologies to try to make sense of. There's always more to do that I can keep up with, but never dull moment working on these issues these days. And so it looks like there may be one more question in the chat on cyber war gaming, or just on war gaming in general as well. And well, that's actually another project that I am trying to get some traction on for a later paper going forward. I've been looking to speak more generally to war gaming and cyber war gaming in particular, but as the Chinese military has in the past couple of years massively expanded efforts in war gaming as an element of national defense education, and has looked to start to use that as a means of training officers and personnel, as well as in some cases training AI systems for war gaming. So I think that one general observation on that front, and more to come, hopefully pending finishing up research on this other paper sooner or later, would be that there appears to be more computerized wargaming in the Chinese system relative to the U.S. So fewer sort of in-person tabletop exercises and more examples of sort of wargaming that's often developed by companies. Another interesting example of military civil fusion that sort of computerized and different scenarios, from simple ground operations to joint and multi-domain operations. I believe there's some war games that are dedicated to cyberspace, and apologies for the background noise. Dog was getting excited for a moment there, and some more people heading back. But there's also more to come on that front. I'm happy to discuss war gaming further.
Great. And we also got one more question, so if you want to keep the questions coming, I guess we'll keep going.
Hi, Elsa. Thanks for taking my question. So to the extent the U.S. could effectively compete with resourcing and financing like China has thrown or allocated to BRI, what organization do you see within the U.S., either governmental or otherwise, that would be most likely to develop a similar plan and lead in its implementation in order to combat some of that expansion?
That's a good question. I think I'm less insightful when it comes to U.S. policy and different organizations in government, but I know that there has been some discussion and some work by colleagues of mine at CNAS looking at the notion of a digital development bank and ways in which there could be more extensive collaboration of the U.S. with allies and partners. So, where the U.S. perhaps alone could not muster the same resources we've seen China dedicating to One Belt, One Road, this could be more of a collaborative or alliance-oriented approach that starts to bring to bear the strengths of different countries and different companies as well, to offer more options to the countries that find, for instance, Huawei appealing as a source of 5G that may want to have other alternatives. So, I think we also, and I look more at this more Chinese policy than U.S. policy, but I would say as well that I think we do need to think more proactively and just be less reactive and not necessarily be sort of investing in different markets or engaging with different countries because China is there. We're doing that to try to identify how do we prioritize which relationships, which investments, which dimensions of some of the broader economic engagements are most important and advantageous, whether in terms of U.S. economic interests or trying to reimagine our diplomacy and more effectively integrate economic statecraft going forward. So that's definitely, I would recommend some of the work that my colleagues at CNAS have been doing from the Asia-Pacific program, looking at options to respond to the China Digital Silk Road. A couple of other colleagues of mine with the Technology Alliance project at CNAS, looking at more ways to work with allies and partners to have a more effective coordination when it comes to technological development. So I think there's definitely some active conversations happening on this front. And I think another perhaps concerning perspective would be, are we trying to combat the BRI, or are there cases where we should stay out of the way of BRI and let it prove to demonstrate its own limitations or shortcomings? That there have been cases where China has faced a backlash because of elements of the BRI that have not been successful, or that have provoked some resentment or concerns among local citizens about the ways in which these projects are being carried out. So perhaps we should be less trying to combat and more sort of promoting our own projects to create a positive comparison and alternatives, and recognizing that some of the downsides of BRI, such as the number of coal plants being built and how they contradict China's new pledge on climate change, some of those contradictions and negative externalities may become clear enough and may provoke concerns that can arise more organically than the U.S. necessarily trying to point them out or push back directly.
Great, thank you. Okay, Major Brown?
All right, thank you, Dr. Valeriano, and our thanks to Ms. Elsa Kania for coming in, especially on short notice, to come on the broadcast and share her amazing research and insights into what's been going on with China and the pandemic. So thanks to her, and thanks to everyone who joined us today. Next week, you will definitely want to join us again, because we are going to be hosting Dr. Edward D. Hess, who is co-author of the book, Humility is the New Smart, Rethinking Human Excellence in the Smart Machine Age. We'll see you all then. Thank you.
Education is what's important. Training, preparation for the expected. Education, preparation for the unexpected.